This is All India Radio, Bangalore and Bhadravati. We now bring you an interview with a well-known Kannada poet, Professor M. Gopalakrishna Adiga. The interviewer is the well-known novelist and critic, Dr. U. R. Anantamurthy.
Professor Adiga,
yes.
About 15 years ago, you were the center of a big literary storm, and we used to meet very regularly in the coffee house and talk about literature and how it should be written, etc. It's a long time since we have been able to meet again and talk like that. So today, I would like to know the way you have been thinking in these days. First, I would like to open the discussion with a question. Some time ago, you made a remark that the great creative effort in India can be seen only in the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. And after that time, we have gone on repeating ourselves. Now, as a visiting fellow in Simla, in the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, you are doing work on poetry, Indian poetic tradition. Do you still hold that view?
What I perhaps vaguely felt some 15 years ago, I am trying to verify and substantiate now. And there has not been any appreciable change in my attitude. I even now believe that the great creative period in our country that began with the Vedas terminated or culminated in the Mahabharata. And after that, for a few centuries, there has been some creative effort. After that, we began repeating the past or imitating what has already been done. And this view I still hold, Mr. Anantamurthy. And
Don't you think that literature which came in the literary tradition has been like that? They have been writing in the framework of the Sanskrit sensibility. But there have been attempts, for instance, in the Vachanakaras and in poets like Kabi, who wrote in the
and
oral
tradition. Vaishnava poets also.
Yes, who wrote in the oral tradition, who could go beyond the framework of our literary tradition and explore something new. Do you consider that this effort was made in a big way?
The effort was made, and in some cases, there were genuine, original efforts at self-expression, I admit it. But they were not of a scale which could include the whole of this country.
Yes.
They were just sporadic expressions of creative energy which could never be suppressed. In every age, there will be creative energy crying for expression. And here and there, some noble examples could be perhaps found. But in range and depth, they could not influence the whole of India.
Yes.
That's what I mean. And
but what about the creative effort made by our writers during the freedom struggle days? You also began writing in those times.
Another creative epoch perhaps began with the advent of the 20th century.
Yes.
And during the freedom struggle, there was really an effort at self-expression. And but the poets of those days were still weighed down by the past so much that they could not do anything monumental.
Yes.
That's what I feel.
Yes.
And in many respects, I feel that the real renaissance in this country has not yet taken place. We have had, from the 19th century onwards, there are some glimmerings of things to come, but the thing has not yet come.
You mean in literature or even in our political, social and cultural life?
I can't separate literature from other aspects of life. And if there is a renaissance, it will be total.
Yes.
The fact that some new things were created in poetry or literature should not make us forget that our music has been stagnant for ages. And in painting also, no epoch-making creations were created.
Yes.
So, if there is a renaissance, it will have to be total.
Yes.
And the whole society has to be overhauled.
Yes.
That has not yet taken place.
Yes.
I admit that there have been attempts to overhaul the whole thing.
Yes.
To set the whole society on a new footing.
Yes.
But they are just attempts.
You mean that a great literary renaissance will come as a result of an awakening in life in all the fields, and since it has not taken place, the creative epoch has also not begun, a new great creative epoch. But would you say that the Western literature, which influenced us, has given our literary imagination a new turn?
I
ask you this question because I wonder whether you think of this renaissance in terms of an impact on the of the West on us, or in terms of going to our roots and finding out, you know, what we are, to our own tradition.
Yes,
in what sense do you think of this new renaissance? I ask you again this question because in your poetry there is such a stress on Indian tradition, you know, nowadays, searching for roots in the tradition and so on. So do you consider this renaissance?
That's a good question. I should try to answer it. Any renaissance in India now cannot take place in isolation. It has to be in the context of the scientific progress that has taken place in the West and which we have been trying to make our own all these years. So the new renaissance, if it should materialize at all, will have to be not just Indian, it should have to be Indian plus. From that point of view, I am quite sure that the influence of the West on our literature and the way in which a study of Western poetry stimulated us has been quite good. And if I search for roots in my poetry, I should like to give what I feel or what I experience in my mind from a study of world literature, a local habitation and a name.
Yes.
Whatever may be your mind, we have a body always.
Yes.
The body has to have a place and a name.
Yeah, but there is another point when I raise this question. There are some people who criticize you, who find your recent stand inadequate because they think that you are a revivalist in the sense you think that we have as men fallen, but there is a lot of wisdom in our ancient Indian tradition. If only we can live according to the model set in the past, everything will be all right. I don't think that you are a revivalist. I myself think, you know, that your imagination is not the imagination of a revivalist. You are elemental in your imagination, so you can't be a revivalist. But I would like you to answer this question. Do you think that there is a remedy for all our ills in the Indian past?
This question I should like to answer in some detail. Personally, I believe that there are certain things which have to be common to all ages. Honesty, truthfulness, a sense of fair play. These are some of the values which are found in all cultures all over the world. And they are found in our country also. And I also believe that the people living in a particular land, country, under particular geographical conditions, mold themselves in a particular manner.
Yes.
And this life has been going on in this country for many thousand years.
Yes.
And there should be some significance in the direction which this country has followed so far. I can never think that anything of the past can be revived. But certain abstract qualities and ideas which are peculiar to this country, I believe, should be preserved. For example, there has been here a disregard of, at least on the idealistic level, worldly prosperity, material advantage, which is described as a spiritual endeavor. Much that goes under this name may be just a hoax. But there is some modicum of truth in that. In this country, in India, for example, it may not be quite good to have the Western attitude to material wants and advantages.
Yes.
I doubt whether we can create the same kind of material wealth as the West has created in our country also. Therefore, somehow or the other, we will have to adjust our present life in the context of the experience of the past, while not forgetting that the past cannot be brought back.
But when you talk about this aspect of India, can't we say, you know, that you are only thinking of a minority culture in India, the Vedic culture, which had these values. But there is life in India which has not come under the influence of the Vedic culture at all. So this is another criticism about you, that you have been talking about the Indian tradition and culture, etc. But it's only a minority culture belonging to a small sect who never shared these values with the vast millions of Indians. What do you say to this?
But the values in India were shared by all the people here. A study of our literature itself will show it. Because in literature also, all people coming from all classes of society participate in it. The whole country had a spiritual turn at that time. The attitude was spiritual, which was accepted by everyone. In fact, 100 years ago, there was no conflict between one community and the other in this country. How it happened, who was responsible for it, it's very hard to say now. But this life continued for ages without any conflict as such, so far as Hindu community is concerned.
But this something continuing for ages, isn't it our trouble? Isn't it the reason why we are stagnant?
I also honestly feel that for the last 1,000 years, life was stagnant here.
Yes.
Changes ought to have taken place. And rising and falling ought to have gone on.
Yes.
As Tagore has said, patana abhyudaya.
Yes.
Some classes coming up, going down, and other sections coming up and going down. This ought to have continued all these years. And I link this with the paucity of creative work during about 700-800 years in the past.
Now, from these problems, I would like to bring you to your own poetry, to see, you know, how you have been dealing with these problems in your own creative work. First, before we go on to that question, may I just know, in a word or two, who are the important influences on you in Canada?
You mean as poets?
Yes, as poets. Who has made it a real impact on you? Who set you writing?
It's very hard to say.
Yes.
In fact, I was essentially a lonely being in my childhood. And I was at a disadvantage with the outside world. And perhaps there's a great urge in me to make myself one with the world, to make myself equal to it. And so I was introspective, imaginative, spent a lot of time thinking, remembering, trying to fill up my mind with the pictures of my own fantasy. This went on. But this whole
atmosphere, very early.
Very early. Even as I was 8 or 9 or 10, I read up all that was secured at that time. And I also began to compose some verses, even when I was 10. How it happened, it's very hard to say.
This is the period you talk about in the early part of your Bhumi Gita.
Yes.
The receptive child.
Go. And no poet, and I see, in fact, in my house, they used to recite Kumar Vyasa or Lakshmisha. I used to sit and listen. There are many Yakshagana performances all around, and I used to go and see them.
Did you read any modern poet then?
Only. Yes, I remember now. Some poems of Bendre and Gelere Gumpu I read when I was in the third form, that was the middle school.
Did it make an impact on you?
I liked it somehow. I didn't know why. Though all around me they liked Jaimini more than anything else, this, I was attracted.
Do you remember of any poem of Bendre which made a great impact on you when you were a child? You know,
when I was about 12 or 13 years. I can't say of Bendre, but some poems used to come in a monthly called Swadharma, which was edited by Bendre himself.
Yes.
So some poems, Madhura Channa perhaps, he made his impact on me first, even prior to Bendre.
Does it explain why there is a mystical strain in you even now?
Maybe.
One gets a feeling, Professor Arigai, when we read you, that total surrender is not possible for you at all, in your poetry particularly, you know. There is an element of your personal ego which remains outside.
Total surrender was possible at that time.
Yes.
But by 15th or 16th year, perhaps my ego was kindled and I rose. And I denied God also for a long time.
Yes. Do you deny God now?
I'm not quite sure. I don't believe in a personal God as such.
Yes.
But since so long as I believe in myself,
yes,
I believe in God.
Yes.
For me, my God is my own heart and conscience, nothing else. Yes.
I ask you this question because, when you were talking about your childhood, for instance, I have often felt that the source of your poetry somewhere comes from your childhood, because the lines that I like most in your poetry sometimes are lines which recall your childhood, that nostalgic element in your poetry. Do you feel that whenever you write, you are stirred deeply and you remember your childhood days and you get most of your images from your childhood days?
I can't say I'm stirred deeply, but when I begin to write, images come mostly from my childhood memories.
This again, I have noticed, when you became the center of a big storm, you published your Chandamaddale. There, the poems are mostly urban. Many of the poems are urban, and even the imagery is urban. People who attack you even now think of you as the poet of Chandamaddale. They don't seem to have recognized your Bhumi Gita. But I wonder why, from the urban scene, you have gone back to the rural locale. Because the imagery in Bhumi Gita is rural and agricultural. Why did you go back?
Perhaps when I rebelled against the earlier modes, my ego was on the ascendant at that time.
Yes.
Ego is more cerebral than a total expression of the inner being. So when I wrote them, perhaps they are more cerebral than a total expression of my inner being.
Yes.
But when this rebellious mood settled down, perhaps when I wanted to see life as whole as possible, I had to go back to my childhood, perhaps. I don't know.
But in your recent poem on Delhi, you have come back to the urban scene. But one notices that when you come back to the urban scene, you talk a little too much. Your poetry doesn't have the same economy and the same power as the one rooted in your childhood days. Is there another reason for this? Why you can't, you can't really deal with the urban scene as well as you can deal with your childhood rural scene? It's not merely you. I don't think that in Canada we have truly any great urban poetry based on urban life. And even Eliot had to go back to his rural this thing. I'm not making it as a criticism.
I understand.
I just want to understand why. Is there any other reason? Is there any reason of language, for instance, that Canada is not yet adopted to the urban scene as much as it is to the rural?
This is what I think, Anandamurthy. Perhaps there has not been a real, well-developed, organic urban life in this country yet.
Yes.
So, urban culture, can we speak of any urban culture in this country?
No.
So, when one writes there, one feels perhaps, writes about it, one lives there, one makes a number of things of the urban situation, his own.
Yes.
And one tries to write about it, perhaps, as you have pointed out, language difficulty arises. And so, perhaps one has not been able to write a really great urban poem so far. I don't know. I can't explain it.
Like Wasteland, I mean.
Yes.
Could you call it an urban poem?
It could. It is an urban poem.
Yes. Now, I have been wanting to ask you a question and I forgot to put this question to you. I should have put it earlier. What I mean is this. How do you write a poem? What is the creative process? Because when I read some of your poems, I am taken by utter surprise. A word, an image, seems to come from a deep unconscious. I have got this kind of feeling. So I would like to know the creative process, you know, how you arrive at it. I have often felt that you are wiser in your poetry than at other times, you see, you know. Seems to go very deep.
Well, the writing of poetry, so far as I am concerned, is a matter of waiting for the right word and the right image. And for this, sometimes, I may require many months. When I begin to write a poem, some lines may come off. But then, I shall keep it there.
Is it the word which comes to you first? I mean, the image or the rhythm? Do you get haunted by a certain rhythm?
Mostly rhythm. Only sometimes, perhaps, an image. I'm more sensitive to rhythm than image.
But nowadays, you know, I get a feeling that an idea comes to you first. Does it?
Maybe. Yes, yes.
Is there a change from Bhumikita, say, to a poem like, shall I say, Ramanavami Adivasa? Is there a change? Do you start with an idea in some of your recent poems?
Some idea, yes. I have not analyzed it. You know that so far as my poems are concerned, I don't analyze them. But perhaps you are right in saying that. Till I wrote Bhumigita, perhaps, I was carried only by rhythm. And I was satisfied if the poem was rhythmically correct. But later, I began to think, use my intellect also. So perhaps, as you have said, nowadays, an idea takes hold of my imagination. I will be brooding over it for a number of days and then begin to write.
Yes.
Write it, but my writing is a very painful process. Therefore, I generally decry inspiration. Though inspiration is there, I know that, because certain words come only through inspiration. There is no denying that. But still, I take a lot of pains. And sometimes a poem may be finished in 3 or 4 days also, but generally they take a very long time. I write and contemplate on them for a number of days and will not give them out till I am satisfied at the time, at that particular time.
Do you find that the same, you know, you have also written many social satires, you know. The creative process there perhaps is different because some people feel with your social satires that you don't really give yourself fully to it, you hold yourself back, you have, they find, you know, that you are bitter and so on.
But that is that not the very nature of a satire?
Yes.
If one gives a full picture, if one completely engages himself in the topic, it will never be a satire. One will be so full of pathos and pity and sympathy that it would be impossible to write. It's only when one is indignant, he writes a satire. And satire is certainly, by its very nature, a simplification. I admit that.
Do you feel that you are completely out of sympathy with the contemporary times? You find everything wrong? Because why should you be always satirical when you write?
This one point which I want to express to you, explain to you. I believe in dissent. I always suspect those ideas which are generally accepted by all the people.
And now another term of yours has become a very controversial term and people have been interpreting it in all sorts of ways. Mannina Vasane, for instance. What did you exactly mean by Mannina Vasane? Because they say you have, your poetry is so full of references to abstract ideas from the Upanishads and so on. So they say, where is Mannina Vasane in Adiga's poetry? It is full of Sanskrit terms. But is there any Mannina Vasane in him? What do you have to say to this?
I don't think that they are fair to me. When I use the word Mannina Vasane, what I meant was this, that whatever we write should spring from what is real and actual. A contact with actual living is absolutely necessary. And everything should spring from that. Now, our actual life, what is it? It is not just eating or digesting it. Our thoughts, our imaginations, our memories, these are also a part of reality. And as a man thinks, grows older and older, perhaps, he will have to digest his actual experience into finer and finer entities. Just as what we eat is sublimated into brain also. So when I said mandinavasana, the smell of the earth, this is what I meant. That at no time literature should lose contact with actual living, actual experience. That's what I meant. And again, you know that in every age, we begin, poets begin by writing in a very realistic manner. But as time passes, poetry either rises, you may say, or becomes more and more abstract. That's the process of it. First we write in the very language spoken by the people, but as a poet grows older and older, his experiences may become more and more individual, and then they will have to be perhaps more and more abstract. But when it becomes too abstract, the poet should stop and think if he wants to grow. He will again come back to the soil. Now that is what I have been trying recently.
Yes. And that was your resolution in Kupamandaluka.
Yes, yes.
To go back,
to the womb of earth once again.
Yes.
But not to stay there. I never meant that one should get oneself submerged in maya, mud. No, you must go there, get the necessary material so that they may be transformed into something brilliant.
So I would like to know what you think about the current literary scene in Kannada. This is my last question.
I can take all criticism because I have been writing not only for the present but for all time. Whether my poetry will stay for all time is a different matter. But when I write it, I have all time in view. At present, there are a number of writers here who want to write only for the present and reap the benefits, material mostly, immediately. If they are frustrated there, they begin to howl at things. This is a very sad thing. You know, Anantamurthy, we write, and if so, we get something out of it, it's good. But essentially, we write for the future generations also, not only for the people around us. And we should not, as a duty, hope for any material advancement coming from our creative activity. If we want that also, then envy enters. And that spoils the whole atmosphere. That is what I am witnessing now, and I am very sorry.
Thank you very much.
That was an interview with Professor M. Gopalakrishna Adiga, the well-known Kannada poet. Dr. U. R. Anantamurthy, the well-known novelist and critic, was the interviewer. This broadcast came to you from All India Radio, Bangalore and Bhadravati.